We know there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk. We know there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
Welcome to Black Health Watch. This is Angela DeJoseph. Tonight we are launching a brand new show just to talk about what is going on in health with African Americans. We decided to do it the same week that the ACA launched across country. We opened the doors to the Affordable Care Act, also known as Obamacare. What does that mean to us in the Black community? I thought we should talk about it. So tonight we're going to have two great guests. The first one is Earl Ofari Hutchinson of the Hutchinson Report. He's going to talk to us about Obamacare, what's going on in the country with the shutdown. This is a really critical time, but for minorities, it's a really essential time that you pay attention. The exchanges are open. You can go up right now and you can enroll. You can start the enrollment process. It's time to get insured. We're going to take a moment. When we come back, we're going to have Earl Ofari Hutchinson, and we're going to talk about what's going on in Washington, D.C. We'll be right back. Well, we're back. This is the first episode of Black Health Watch, and we're going to talk about the Black community and what is going on in our health. The biggest news of the day is the Affordable Care Act, and the enrollment started this week. But the government shut down. On the phone, we've got Earl Ofari Hutchinson. And Earl, hello. Welcome to the show.
Yes, I'm here. How are you?
I'm fine. Thank you so much for calling in today. So, Earl, this is the most important day that we've had. We've opened up Obamacare finally, and then the government shuts down. What is up with that?
Well, there's two things. The Republican Party, and we're only talking about really a minority of Republicans in the House primarily, primarily affiliated with the Tea Party, the most conservative wing of the Republican Party. They made it clear from day one, we don't want to see the Affordable Care Act, period. House Republicans have voted 41 times to defund the Affordable Care Act. And they essentially have said this time, with the October 1st, of course, start of the Affordable Care Act, and also coming at the same time as the budget, you know, as we're going into fiscal year 2013, 2014, obviously, we have to have a budget. Mm-hmm. So what they have done is they've welded it together and said, essentially, unless we get a delay, they know they're not going to defund. That's not going to happen. The Senate will never, ever approve that. But the other fallback was that let's get a delay. We want that delay for 1 year. And in return for that, what we'll do is essentially we will go ahead with budget deliberations, namely pass a budget.
But what does that have to do with the budget? What does the Affordable Care Act have to do with the budget for the country to run?
It doesn't really have anything to do with it, but the GOP has made it an issue. In other words, what they've done is they've held the Affordable Care Act hostage. Or at least they tried to do that.
Mm-hmm. And but it's funded anyway.
Well, unfortunately, they have partially succeeded. The Affordable Care Act obviously went into law, became law, and came into force October 1st. It will be fully implemented January 1st. Mm-hmm. However, as you know, millions of people signed up through the insurance exchanges, mm-hmm, that are mandated.
I think 10 million people went to the exchange the first day.
Oh, yeah, yeah. You had millions of people that essentially dialed up different health care providers and also explored the health care exchanges through Covered California. Mm-hmm. In fact, demand was so great, as you well know, that the system broke down for
right,
a minute.
Right.
It was just so heavily used.
Well, that was a good sign that so many people were interested in the first day, particularly with all of the things that they were saying to scare people off from the Affordable Care Act.
Yeah, well, you know, that's been the GOP all along. I mean, their big fallback argument is the Affordable Care Act is going to drive small businesses out of business. It's an infringement upon our First Amendment rights because it mandates that everyone has to have health care, and obviously that's something that we Americans resist in terms of our individual rights. Then another fallback has been, well, you're going to pay through the nose down the line because all the hidden costs simply are, you know, haven't been reported. So, you know, it's gone on and on and on from day one. I mean, they have fought this thing tooth and nail from the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
And quite frankly, it doesn't show, even at this point, even though it is the law of the land.
Right.
And it's going to essentially be fully implemented. They still haven't given up. They're still going to come up with different little tactics and ploys to essentially try to, if not kill it, at least make it seem like it's a total failure.
Well, I don't think the people are going to allow it. Because did you see the veterans the other day? People are angry. At this point, people are finally realizing that there is one party that's obstructing this going forward. And I think holding up the budget for the government and people, 800,000 people being put out of work, I think that's the final straw.
Well, it's the final straw for some, but not the GOP. I mean, they're playing hardball with this.
Mm-hmm.
And unfortunately, at least in the House, they have the numbers at this point because the GOP controls the House and they control their leadership, too. I mean, you've seen John Boehnert, who is mm-hmm. the House Majority Leader. Essentially, he sounded like the Tea Party. He's caved in and essentially said no deal. And even though they had talks at the White House on the shutdown trying to figure out how to resolve it, and of course they'd come up with every little piecemeal thing, well, why don't you pass some spending measure to cover this, cover that, cover the cost of this? And of course the president has said no, and the Democrats have said no. Listen, Congress, people forget one thing. Congress, not the White House. Congress, not the executive branch. In the Constitution, it's the House of Representatives that's responsible for taxation, the raising of revenue, and setting policy on that. That includes the budget. They've reminded people time and time again, look, the budget is your responsibility, not the White House's. You pass it. These are debts that are old. Now, essentially, just like we've done for over 200 years since we had a republic, you've got to pass it. We've got to have a budget. We've got to go forward.
Earl, how long do you think they're going to hold out? How long did they hold out in 1995 when Newt Gingrich was there with President Clinton?
In 1995, it was 3 days.
Oh, 3 days. Okay. So how long do you think it'll go this time?
Don't know. Don't know. Remember, the latest that we know, at least as of this point, the talks have broken down. The Speaker of the House, they have essentially said that no, that it's not going to happen until we get what we want. In other words, what they have done because of public anger. You mentioned the veterans before.
Right.
You mentioned federal employees mm-hmm. and all the other services that are dependent in one way, shape, or form, directly or indirectly, you know, on government services and government procurement. What has happened is the GOP, because of that public anger, they said, well, we'll put some spending measures up, but that's not acceptable. You have to pass a budget. It's mandated by law. You can't pick and choose, you know, you're going to fund this, not fund that. That's never been done before. It can't be done now.
What about, there was a way that we could stop the paycheck for the people in Congress? I know that there's actually something on one of the sites where you can sign a petition that they don't get paid until they pass a budget.
Yeah. Well, the petition's not going to mean anything. It's mandated by law that Congress must be paid. However, what some have done in Congress, which I find very interesting, but also I find very hypocritical, you have some senators and you have some House representatives that, one, say they will not accept the paycheck, and then you have others that say, well, we'll take our check and we'll donate it to charity.
Mm-hmm.
That's not acceptable. The fact of the matter is, you've got almost 1 million federal employees. and others that aren't getting paid at all. They're on involuntary furlough, and we don't know if they'll ever be paid. I mean, even though obviously there'll be a settlement at some point, we don't know whether they'll be paid or not for the time that was missed on, of course, anything that had they had to do.
And they had nothing to do with this.
No.
But also,
this was imposed upon them.
The National Institutes of Health, some of those departments have been closed. And there was, for example, they were talking about the children that can't get the experimental cancer treatments. And they were trying to put the responsibility on the Democrats, as if the Democrats are trying to stop that. Do you think that if they start to partially fund things, that would weaken the argument to just fund the entire government?
No. Well, it's not going to happen. The fact is, you can't pick and choose like, you know, smorgasbord, buffet. This is what we want. This is what we don't want. This is what we're going to fund. This is what we're not going to fund. Just think about that. If you set that precedent, that's a dangerous precedent, then who's to say a year down the line? I mean, you have to have a budget every year. Mm-hmm. It's mandated under law. Who's to say next year you have some congressmen or congresspersons that will say, but we don't want to fund the National Endowment for the Arts. We don't want to fund the air traffic controllers. We don't want to fund this because we don't like that. You see where that would go?
Right.
So, no,
right.
It just can't happen.
Now, what about the debt ceiling? That's coming up right behind this.
October 17th, and this looms even bigger. The Treasury has already said, if, in fact, the debt ceiling is not increased by October 17th, we'll run out of money. What would that mean? That would be catastrophic. As you know, the full faith and credit of the U.S. government is behind every borrowing, lending instrument, treasury bills, treasury notes, bonds, you name it. And, I mean, it's the safest bet in the world. So if that was to happen, not to mention the fact is bills still have to be paid. If that was to happen, once again, we don't know. The GOP, they made noise about holding that hostage, too. Then we could be right back, even if there's a settlement in the next few days, in another week, we could be right back to ground zero again with the GOP once again screaming loudly, we're not going to raise the debt ceiling unless you do A, B, and C. Back again on the Affordable Care Act.
Unbelievable. Well, we are getting ready to go to commercial, Earl. Can you hang around just a minute? I'd like to ask you another question when we come back from commercial.
Okay,
thank you. We're going to take a break. We'll be right back. We're talking to Earl Afari Hutchison. We are talking about the country, the shutdown. We'll be right back. You're watching Black Health Watch.
To those who've worried, suffered in silence, hoped, and lived in a state of fear, welcome to a new state of health. Welcome to Covered California, the place to find quality, affordable coverage, financial help for those in need, and nobody can be denied because of a pre-existing condition. Learn more at coveredca.com.
Did you know social media produces almost double the marketing leads of trade shows, telemarketing, direct mail, or even pay-per-click ads? And that about 46% of all online users count on social media when making that ever-important purchase decision. Hey, if you feel lost when it comes to social media, Top Tier Media can help you. Top Tier Media specializes in social media management and blogger outreach for beauty, fashion, health, and lifestyle brands. To learn more, go to www.toptiermedia.com. That's www.toptiermedia.com. Top Tier Media, the official social media marketing company of LA Talk Live and the Talk Live Broadcast Network.
You're watching Black Health Watch with Angela DeJoseph. We're talking about the Affordable Care Act. We also have to talk about the government shutdown. Joining us on the phone is Earl Afari Hutchinson. He's been kind enough to call in and talk about what's going on. Earl, I wanted to talk about the Black community. This show is designed to talk about the health disparities and how we're going to get our community healthier. What do you think the impact overall of the Affordable Care Act will be on the Black community?
Well, I think it would be tremendous. In fact, I wrote an op-ed column, the Affordable Care Act, Obamacare, if you want to go that direction. The Affordable Care Act is a magnificent triumph, especially for African Americans. Why? For several reasons. Number one, you have, by every figure I've ever seen, every study, every survey, you have 40 to 50 million people that are uninsured in America, meaning absolutely, no matter even if the insurance was available, the fact is they have no access to it, let alone quality health care. We know a disproportionate percentage of the 40 to 50 million estimated of those without insurance are African American, not to mention underinsured, you know, untold numbers more. That's number one. The second thing is that when you look at every health malady, heart attack, cancer, stroke, diabetes, obesity, I mean, it goes on and on and on. African Americans suffer disproportionate numbers or percentages of those that are stricken with physical and emotional maladies. And so right away, you can see that there's been a huge need for affordable quality health care. And so this opens it up for many African Americans.
Well, many people in the Black community also have been reluctant to go to the doctor for two reasons. One, I mean, obviously, the not having health insurance, but also there's a trust issues with the medical profession that dates back to, you know, people say you're still talking about the Tuskegee experiment, but yes, there's still things in our modern history.
That's true, but I think when you really look at it objectively, you know, I wouldn't make more of that than it actually is. The fact of the matter is we have seen, and studies have borne this out, that where quality health care or affordable health care is available, Africans overwhelmingly partake of that. They make use of that. I mean, the fact of the matter is that we know, as African Americans and certainly those that are very aware of the health problems and the health needs in our community, that essentially health is crucial. And that's why many people, myself included, regard not health as a privilege like some of our conservative friends do, but a civil right.
Absolutely.
I mean, it does say the right to life, liberty, and pursuit of happiness. I don't know if you can have much liberty and pursuit of happiness
if you don't have your health.
Got to have health. So I think we're aware of that. And I think that African Americans, where health care is available and it's affordable, we will partake of it.
Well, do you think that we are going to really sign up? Because, you know, they haven't put the marketing dollars into our community as yet. At least I haven't seen it.
Right. Well, there, yes, we will. That's a short answer to it. The other problem is that there are different plans. As you know, you have the bronze, you have the silver, you have the platinum, you have the gold. So each plan has different types of coverage and different types of cost. And so there are levels of affordability. I think we start with the premise, Angela. First of all, it's available.
Yes.
You have to have insurance.
And everybody has to sign up.
You cannot discriminate because, as certainly insurance carriers did in the past, because of any precondition. I mean, I think that was huge, eliminating
the pre-existing conditions.
So we start with that. But the problem is, again, affordability. Now, that's been partially answered, as you know, because of if you have a certain income or you come underneath a certain income, $25,000, I think $45,000 for a family of more, might be a little bit higher than that, depending on the state. If that happens, then, of course, you know, there will be a partial subsidy or a tax credit. So I think that will be helpful, too. That will be of immense value in terms of lower-income folk. And as we well know, a disproportionate number of African Americans fall into that category. I think that will be important in terms of making health care much more affordable and accessible to them and us.
What would you suggest, for example, we're in California, we're one of the first states to roll out with Covered California. What would you suggest that Covered California do to reach the Black community more effectively?
Well, I think two things. Number one, I did note that Covered California is running the PSA, and I heard it on your show. I think that's important. I think on all African-American oriented programs, networks, every venue, every platform that reaches a general public, an African-American public, that could be radio, newspapers, TV, and in general. I think that Covered California needs to have, and they are doing that, it appears, certainly a major, major public outreach to let people know this is a law, this is what's available, here's a website or a phone number, this is where you can go to get information on that. I think the second thing, too, is I think a lot depends on insurers. You know, those that are involved in offering coverage, and of course that could be anybody, well, there are many of them that are involved. And I think they have a duty and an obligation, too, to do some outreach. Let them know we have plans, we have programs, we're part of this, we're part of the coverage plan, and certainly we invite you to explore the possibility of providing us, letting us provide you with insurance.
Well, Earl, just so you know, I've been talking with some of the other people in the that are in the black media, and the money has not been allocated to our community yet, to the media. So that's something that we're looking forward to because we're anxious to be a part of getting the word out. And I'm doing this show particularly because I have an interest in educating our community because I realize how important it is. Because a lot of people wait so late when they don't have health insurance to go to the doctor. And by the time something is discovered, it's too late. So we're doing, as a matter of fact, we have a cancer event this weekend that we're doing. We're giving free mammograms. And so many women that are well over 40 have never, black women, have never had a mammogram. And they are not getting regular checkups because they've fallen through the cracks. They don't have health insurance. But they also are not poor enough to qualify for the county programs either.
Well, okay. That's true, but let's look ahead for a minute. Mm-hmm. You know, 50 years ago, and it will be 50 years in 2015, that we will celebrate the half-century mark for Medicare. When that went into effect, by the way, conservatives fought Medicare tooth and nail, too. They said, it's socialized medicine. Yeah, you know, it looked like the Soviet Union back then. Cuba, you know, China, all these places. You know, it's not going to work, blah, blah, blah. Well,
so you've heard it before.
Something. We found something. 5 years after Medicare went into effect, it became universal in terms of those that qualified, were eligible, and used the service. It was a lifesaver for generations since then. Here's a guess. You know, we're in the opening stage. It's a new law. This is something new. It's historic. I think what you're going to see, Angela, in the beginning, there are going to be some glitches. I mean, it's new.
Right.
It's new. It's just coming into effect. Mm-hmm. I think, let's say, a year down the line, you know, after some of the glitches have been worked out, we can begin to see now more people are aware that you have to have insurance. This is what's available. I think some of the problems that we're seeing now, those that, that as you said before, fall in the cracks or fall between the cracks, those of whatever reason may be reluctant to do, you know, to have checkups and take care of their health care needs and also preventative care, too. There's a lot of money, as you know, that would be spent on that.
Yes.
I think we'll see some of these problems, you know, resolve themselves, but it's going to take time.
Well, I think people are starting to learn. I mean, I think people have heard now that you can keep your children on after until they're 26 on your insurance. And but I think the idea of not being having the caps. So if something happens to you out of your control, usually the insurance company could just drop you after a certain amount of money that they've spent out. Now there's no more caps. The other thing is that employers now are going to have to offer insurance if they have, I think, over 50 employees.
Right. Well, there's another problem there, too. As you know, the GOP, they've been very crafty with this and how they've come at it. Well, really not crafty. They've been very crude. And how they attacked the Affordable Care Act. The other fallback is they've gone to small and medium-sized businesses and said, you know what, now you're going to be forced out of business because you've got to buy all this insurance and provide it for your employees. And as a result of that, now you're not going to be able to afford it. It's going to be costly. It's going to be a business killer. I mean, we've heard that over and over again.
But it's not true.
Well, a couple of problems. Number one, as you know, those that have more than 50 employees, those employers, anyway, about 97%, the overwhelming majority, they have health insurance plans anyway. Now, as far as the small businesses go, you know, as you know, it's been put on hold for a year.
But they're also going to get subsidies too. So if someone has a small business, there also are funds available to subsidize it so that you can afford. They don't want you to go out of business. They actually want to grow the economy, which is the path that we were on. So they're providing subsidies for those.
Well, the other thing, too, is one other ploy that's been used. Mm-hmm. That is true. The second thing is, as you know, there's a cap on the hours, too. It's not just the number of employees, the hours you work. So what we're seeing now is some of the majors are saying, okay, we're just going to go to a part-time workforce. We're going to keep all of our employees, or a number of them, under 29 hours or not higher. We've seen some of that, too. I think that'll fall by the wayside in time. But, you know, these are the kinds of things, the scare tactics that we have to live with for the time being.
Well, I have a good report. Did you see that Disney World, they are now going to take all, I think it's 427 part-time employees and bump them up to full-time and give all of them insurance.
So, yeah, and that's what I mean. Mm-hmm. Because as this thing evolves, as this thing over time, and my guess is it will be a short period of time, I think you'll see what Disney, the Disney World, the Disney Corporation has done and others, I think you'll see many other employees, employers, I should say, fall in line. I'll tell you why. Because health care is a right, and because a healthy workforce is a productive workforce. I mean, this is a no-brainer, and I think the more far-sighted and far-seeing employers, I think they know that, they see that. It's to their advantage to have health care provided. Who wants to have, I mean, just think of the cost of having employees that are turning over and over again, sick, not there. I mean, just the hours of productivity, that's lost. So essentially, for a fraction of the cost, to have a health care plan in place, partially subsidized, I think it's just good business sense.
Oh, it absolutely is. And the other thing is that it costs the taxpayers, because when people don't have, for example, a doctor, they and don't get preventive health care, they end up in the emergency room, and then they can't pay the bill if they're admitted into the county hospital. So the taxpayer ends up paying for that anyway. So why not let people get insurance?
Well, and the GOP, in their zeal, their mania, what I consider lunacy, to gum up the works, to stall everything, to take our marbles and go home just because they don't want to see this go through. Essentially, they don't tell people, look, you still got to pay. In this society, you know, people don't die on the street. We don't let what they do.
Right.
But, I mean, technically, a person has the right to treatment. That means if you don't have insurance, you got to go to a public health facility, an emergency ward. Now, who's going to pay for that?
Right.
Exactly. You pay for it. And you pay through the nose.
Right. And that's why this actually originally was a Republican idea. So that's,
you know,
that's
that,
the funny part.
Yeah,
this was, right, the, this the Heritage Foundation?
Yeah,
this was originally their idea.
You've got to have your cake and eat it, too.
Right.
You got to remember one thing. This has nothing to do, nothing whatsoever to do with the debt, a debt ceiling. It has nothing to do with the budget. It has nothing to do with any of that. It has everything to do with a very, very rigid, a very, very determined, and I consider a very diabolical political agenda. And what's that political agenda? It's the same agenda that's been there for the last 5.5 years that Obama has been in the White House. I mean, anything. If Obama says the sun is shining in the sky, and therefore let's enjoy it, we're going to say, oh, no, we don't want the sun in the sky. Anything that this president, any initiative, any program, doesn't matter what it is or has been knee-jerk, reflexively opposed. Why are we surprised that the GOP, just like they've opposed everything else that the president, of course, has put forth in the Democrats, why would we be surprised that they make any exception for the Affordable Care Act? It's the same pattern of obstructionism and getting this president at any cost.
Well, the good part is that the Affordable Care Act opened as it was supposed to open, and millions of people went, and we are up and on our way, and it's funded. Earl, I am so glad you got to call us today so we could have this conversation. I hope you will call again, because I really always learn when I listen to your show on the radio. So I really hope you'll call us, and help us stay informed. So this was the first, this was our first one, and so we look forward to talking to you again. So thank you so much for calling in today.
All right, it's been my pleasure, and you can count on it.
Okay.
Take care now.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Okay. Well, this is Angela D. Joseph. You've been watching Black Health Watch. Well, this was the first show, and we talked to Erla Fari Hutchinson. Coming up at 6 o'clock is the Angela D. Joseph Show. Stay tuned. We're going to have someone from Covered California here. He's going to tell us the ins and outs of the Affordable Care Act. We'll be back at 6 o'clock. Stay tuned. Thank you for watching.
To those who've been waiting for health insurance, welcome to Covered California. To those who've been waiting for health insurance, welcome to Covered California. The place to find quality, affordable coverage, and nobody can be denied because of a pre-existing condition. Learn more at coveredca.com.